All right. One announcement I want to make prior to the service, and then we got several more I'll make at the end of the service, but I want to make sure this goes out online so everybody knows that we will be starting Vacation Bible School tonight. Tonight, Vacation Bible School, the meal will be served at 5:45. The classes and such will begin at 6:20, and they'll end at 8:15. The adult class will be here in the sanctuary at 6:30. And most of that, as much as we can, we're going to hold outside. When that was the plan to begin with, hold most of it. We know it's going to be a little warm, and it's summertime, and that's okay. So just bear with us. Give us your patience, and everything will be just fine. So if you're part of Vacation Bible School, they're going to have a quick meeting just right up here. Right up here, right after the service. If you're part of Vacation Bible School, come right up here and meet with Sister Kathy after that. One other thing, and then we'll get on into the service. If you are not on our text or email list, text, email, phone call, you don't have to be a member. That's the only way we have of contacting everybody if something comes up. And so if you're not on that list, plus that's the way we send out prayer requests, any other information about the church, anything special going on, it's just the only way we have to get things out. So if you're not, whether you're a member, whether you're not, doesn't matter. Alicia, raise your hand, please. That is Sister Alicia. You need to give her your phone number to be texted to, your email address, however we need to contact you so we can get a hold of you. We want to make sure we get a hold of everybody, okay? So at the end of the service, run up to her, ask her for $5. You're probably not going to get that, but she'll put you on the list anyway. All right? She may charge you. I don't know. But anyway, all right, so don't forget that. All right, I'm going to preach on some scriptures I think I spoke on just not many weeks ago. I think it was on a Wednesday night, but I'm not sure, and it's in James chapter 5. Bear with me. I'm going to try to be as brief as I can today, but I want to get the message across because it's been on my heart a lot for the last couple weeks. James chapter number 5. I love illustrations at times, and I read one about prayer. Said a pastor had a cat that had kittens, and he didn't know how he was going to get rid of all the kittens, but he was trying to place them out, and he'd been able to place a few and still had some left. Well, one of the kittens one day climbed up in a tree, and it got up in the top of the tree. It was scared to come down. The pastor couldn't get up to it. He couldn't figure out what to do. So finally, he said, "Lord, we're just going to commit this kitten into your hands. You're keeping. Need you to help me to get this cat down." He then put feet to his prayers. He took a rope. He tied it to the high as he could get up in this tree. He hooked the other end of the rope to his car bumper. He backed up and backed up and backed up, and his plan was to get the tree bent over far enough to where he could reach the cat from the ladder. So he backed up and backed up, and the tree bends down. And about that time, the rope breaks. The cat goes shooting out of the tree. Pastor don't know where it went. Can't find it. Looks for it. Can't find it. The next day, goes to the grocery store. It was well known that the lady that lived down the street hated cats. It was well known that fact. He goes to the grocery store. He sees her, and she's buying cat food. He said, "I've got to ask you, why are you buying cat food? I know you hate cats." She says, "Well, my daughter's begged me for a cat for months, and I just told her, no, I don't like cats." She said, "And yesterday, my daughter asked me again, can I have a cat?" She said, "I told her, no." Said, "I watched my daughter go out in the backyard, knelt down and prayed for God to send her a cat, and you wouldn't believe it if I told you, but one come flying out of the air into my daughter's arms. And so we're going to keep the cat." So I said all that to say this. We ought to pray about everything, amen? Little girl prayed about a kitten, she got a kitten. The pastor was praying about a home for all those kittens, he found a home. We don't know how God's going to move. We don't know how God's going to direct things, but we do know that God's in control, and just as Sister Kathy just sang, we know his anchor holds, amen? Whatever comes our way, we know God is in control. God is in control. I know prayer, I preach on it quite often. Truly, it's one of my favorite subject matters to preach on because I truly believe it's one of the most utilized things that we have at our disposal, that we just simply don't pray. And when I simply don't pray sometimes as I should, because God's speaking to my heart today about something, and I had the whole message laid out, and then now I've changed it around, so you're going to have to bear with me while I do a little flipping around here and there. But James, in these verses I want to read, which is verse 13 through verse 16, in these four verses, James is going to show us when we should pray. As I said, I'm going to try not to be too lengthy, but James is going to show us when we should pray. Let's go ahead and read those verses. James chapter number 5, verse 13 through verse 16 says this. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the privilege to be back here today, Lord, behind this sacred desk, Lord. And now we pray that as we look at these scriptures, Lord, you would just speak to our hearts. Lord, we know today may not be long, may not be lengthy, Lord God, but we pray that it is in depth, Lord, to speak to our hearts, our minds, and our souls, and show us the necessity of prayer, when we should pray and how we should pray, Lord God, and that we should never fail to pray. So, Father, I just pray that you'd be in the midst of everything. We thank you for the songs that were sang, the music that was played. And, Father, we just pray that you'd have your will and your way in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. So, you know as well as I do, life is full of unusual, sporadic things that happen all the time in each and every one of us. We have good days. We have bad days. There's no one here that doesn't have good and bad days. And I'm going to stop there, and I was going to say this later on. I'll probably say it later on. I'm going to say it now too, though. I'm thankful that God knows how to balance our lives with good days and bad days. We would sit here and think that if every day we had was good, our life would be wonderful. I don't think that's the case. I think many times when everything goes great, everything goes good, and there is no adversity whatsoever, we start to lose focus. We start to slip in some areas that we shouldn't, and it takes the offset of trouble, trials, persecution, and problems in our lives to bring that balance that we need to be the person that God wants us to be. Amen? So God knows how to balance our lives. And you know as well as I do and we do, and we've seen it happen in our in lives, in our church, is when we think everything is going just like it should, it can change in a moment. An auto accident, a call from the doctor, whatever the case may be, our lives can change in a moment. But James gives us the solution here. He tells us here in these verses four times that we need to make sure that we're praying. Four times. Bear with me as we're going to mix them up just a little bit here. Number one, let's look in verse number 13. The Bible says here, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. That word afflicted means to undergo hardship. It means to suffer trouble. It includes trouble, disappointment, persecution, hardship. All these things are wrapped up in that one word, afflicted. So James is saying, when trouble comes your way, when hardship comes your way, when affliction comes your way, when persecution comes your way, when anything enters into your life, James says there's one thing that you should do, and that's pray. Well, preacher, I know that. I've heard you say that, and I know that. And I know you know that, and I know that. But it's one thing to know it. It's another thing to implement it. James says, is any among you afflicted? So is there anybody here today that's having hardships, that's having trouble in their lives, trouble with their kids, trouble in their marriage, trouble on the job? Are you being persecuted in any way? Do you have hardships in your life of any kind? If there's anybody here that meets that criteria today, James said, pray. Amen? And I'm sure I'm not the only one that could meet that criteria here today. Criteria. Let's see what David had to say to us in the book of Psalms. Bear with me as I've got several scriptures I want to flip to, and I've tried to mark most of them. Psalms 34, verse 4 through 8. Listen what David says. I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. They looked unto him and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him and delivereth them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. David said, the poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. Amen. I think many times, and myself included, when we have things that come into our lives that don't seem maybe like large, influential, life-changing things, even though we know it's trouble and it's heartache and it brings hardship, I'm bad to back up and say, I'll just take care of it. When James said, and David tells us, that we should cry unto the Lord, he will hear our cry and he'll deliver us from all our troubles. If I told you that I knew someone and give you a phone number and wrote it down and passed it out and said, if you will call this number and you will talk to this person on the other end of the line, they have the answer and the solution to all your troubles, you would race to the car to dial them up before you got home to relieve yourself of the troubles. And yet many times we choose not to go to God in prayer. God, I'll take care of this. I know you're a busy God. You got a lot going on. That's not the God I serve. The God I serve can take care of everything at once. Amen? Everything at once. James says, is there any among you afflicted? Let him pray. We're going to have trouble. Peter told us that. Look what Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. He puts it rather bluntly here when he says this, 4 and 12, beloved, he's talking to the church, talking to the brothers and sisters in Christ. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. Now, how many of us are that way, that when something happens in our lives, something unexpected occurs in our lives, we act like, what happened? Why would that happen to me? Why would that happen to my family? Why would that happen to our church? Why would these things happen? Peter said, hey, don't be surprised. Bad things happen to good people. Bad things are going to occur in your lives. But James says, when they do, pray. When they do, pray. So when we are afflicted, when we're suffering hardships, James says to pray. Let me move on a little bit. I'm going to come back. So bear with me, but I'm going to come back in a moment if I don't lose all this stuff. Let's go down to verse 14, first part of 15. He says, is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. So James tells us that we should pray when we're afflicted. Hardships, troubles, trials, persecutions, things come into our lives. James says, pray. James also says here, when we are sick, we should pray. Most of us don't have an issue with that. In fact, most of us, that is the time that we're driven to prayer, is when sickness invades our bodies or someone very close to us. But James tells us here, let me read it again. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let him pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Now, the oil here has no special power. The oil in that day was considered medicinal. They used it for all kinds of healing processes. So the power is not in the oil. The power is not in the oil. I have a little thing of anointing oil on my desk. There is no power in that little bottle. Amen? Outside of the Lord Jesus Christ, all power comes from God. Power's not in the oil, the power's in God. The power's not in the elders, the power's in God. Amen? And the elders reach out to God. So anyway, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. I want to read to you in the book of Isaiah. Very, very familiar scriptures, but I think it would do us good to read them. In Isaiah chapter number 53, in verses 4 through 6, the Bible says this. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. So this passage of scripture that I just read tells you and I that Jesus took our sins upon him when we were on the cross. But it goes farther than our sins. It says that he took, and it talks about our griefs, our sorrows, our transgressions, our iniquities. And then he said we are healed because of what Jesus did on the cross. The New Testament puts it this way in 1 Peter 2:24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness. Listen, by whose stripes ye were healed. So healing, according to the word of God in Isaiah and in 1 Peter, healing has a direct link to the cross of Christ. Healing is directly linked to what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary for you and I. So every time that God chooses to heal me, to heal you, to heal anyone else, it is a direct focus to the cross of Calvary. Because it's by his stripes that we have been healed. And we do know, and I made this statement a few weeks ago, I don't remember if it was Wednesday night, Sunday, when it was. We do know that sickness is caused by sin. But we also know that not all sickness is a direct result of a personal sin. But we know that sin that came into the world with Adam and Eve, when sin entered mankind and entered into the world, that men then began to die. And from the day that you and I were born, we began to die. Amen? That's something we don't like to think about. Especially with a young baby. We don't like to think about that. But from the day we're born, there's not a certain age that we reach. And then we start downhill. From the day we're born, our bodies begin to die. Because of sin that has entered the world. So sin is directly linked to the... Or not sin, rather. Healing is directly linked to the cross of Calvary. Now, healing comes in one of three ways. Number one, God can choose you to heal you from the sickness. What do I mean? I mean God can, and God can choose to touch someone and miraculously heal them in an instant, in a moment. God can touch someone and the cancer can leave their bodies. God could touch someone, some other disease, leave their bodies. Or God could give healing or a sight to someone that's never seen, or hearing to someone that's never heard. God has the ability to heal by divine power immediately. And sometimes he chooses to do that. I've experienced that. I have seen that. Amen. And I'm sure many of you could testify to the same thing. So the first way God chooses to heal is heal us from the sickness by divine power. But not only that, God heals us through the sickness. What do I mean? I mean, we get sick and God maybe doesn't heal us miraculously with the divine touch at that moment, but he chooses to heal us through medications, through doctors, and our own bodies healing themselves. Our bodies are an unbelievable, miraculous thing in themselves. You think about, I know me growing up, I stayed hurt growing up because I constantly did something I shouldn't have been doing. So I was all the time cut up, beat up, something all the time. I mean, it was nothing. If I went out the door, odds are I was coming back in bleeding. That's just the way it was. If my body couldn't have healed itself over all these years with all the cuts and gashes I've had, Can you imagine what you would look like if your body? I have very few scars. I was looking down. I have a little scar right here where my mother said, don't play in the creek. So what did I do? I played in the creek. Not only did I play in the creek, I found a bottle buried in the creek. Bottles tend to break. It broke in my hand. It cut the main artery in my thumb. I'll never forget running to my home. And every time my heart would beat, blood would squirt. Blood would squirt. And I've still got a little scar right there. I don't know if I've got a scar on my lip or not. I don't think I do. But I remember Mom and Dad says, don't climb the fence. So what do? Climb the chain link fence. That's before they started putting the spikes down so kids wouldn't get hurt on them. So I hooked my lip on the chain link fence and I just ripped half my lip off. Go back in the house. So I stayed cut up. But if my body couldn't heal itself, and God chooses to heal us sometimes miraculously by divine power, by divine intervention, other times he chooses to use doctors as well as our own bodies and medicines to heal us. The third way God chooses to heal is he heals us by the sickness or through the sickness unto his glory. Simply meaning there's a day and a time that we may get sick and our bodies lay down for the last time. The ultimate healing from God will come on our last breath on this earth. And then God will heal this body and we'll have a new body like unto his that will never ever experience sickness again. Amen? So God does heal. God can heal. And let me say something, church. For a Christian, there are a lot of things worse than death. I read a quote by Dwight L. Moody, and it says that he was traveling by boat on one of the Great Lakes when a really bad storm came up. The other passengers on the boat cowered in fear. They even started an impromptu prayer meeting, asking God to deliver them from the storm. Preacher Moody did not join in that prayer meeting. And he was asked, why would you not come join the prayer meeting? He said this, I have a sister in Chicago. I have a sister in heaven. I don't care which one I see tonight. Amen? There are a lot of things worse than death to a child of God. Now don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that we should sit and look forward to dying. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying you shouldn't do something to try to stay alive. That's not what I'm saying at all. I'm just saying as a child of God, there's a lot of things worse. So, we see that James here, is any afflicted? Let him pray. Then he goes on to say, is any sick among you? Let him pray. Verse 15, latter part of 15 and 16. He says, if any have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So the third thing I want you to see here is we need to pray when we've sinned. We need to pray when we've sinned. Again, here's another close correlation or relationship between sin and the physical and the spiritual with the cross. With the cross. By his stripes ye are healed. David, we all know King David, a man after God's own heart, yet David committed some terrible sins. And I want you to read here what David said about that after committing those terrible sins. In the book of Psalms, chapter number 32, a psalm of David, in verse number 3 and verse number 4, listen what David says. When I kept silence, that means when I didn't repent, when I didn't confess my sins to a holy God. When I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. For day and night, thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned to the drought of summer. Selah. What David is saying is, when I refused to repent of my sins, when I refused to speak to God about the errors of my ways, when I refused to come clean before a holy God, God's heavy hand of judgment was upon me, and the strength began to leave my body. So James is saying here, when we have sinned, and I didn't say if you sin, when we have sinned, that we should pray. Again, let me go back to what I said earlier. I am not telling you that every time someone gets sick that they've got a personal sin in their life. I don't believe the Bible teaches that at all. I do believe that all sickness goes back to the original sin of mankind. and it's brought upon by sin. But it does not mean that just because someone has been diagnosed with something or they're sick with something or whatever the case may be, that they themselves have done something atrocious that has brought that on. In other words, we do not serve a God. Listen to me real closely. We do not serve a God that is sitting back on his throne waiting for you to do something wrong so he can afflict you with something to punish you. That's not the God we serve. We serve a merciful, graceful God that simply wants you to turn back to him, confess your sins, that he can forgive you of your sins. So we need to pray. We need to pray when we're afflicted. We need to pray when we're sick. We need to pray when we've sinned. We need to pray aggressively because God can do more than you could ask or even imagine. We need to pray fervently, as the Bible said a moment ago, that in verse 16, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. But we need to pray very submissively to a holy God, knowing that he knows what's best for our lives. And listen to this last thing. We need to pray. We need to come, as the Bible says, come into the throne of God boldly, into the Holy of Holies boldly. We need to pray specifically. But you listen to me and listen to me close to what I'm about to say. When it says come boldly, it doesn't mean arrogantly. We need to understand that our prayers are requests to a holy God. They're not demands of a holy God. I hear that quite often now on TV with different things and people standing before school board meetings or standing before their senators or whoever, and they'll say, "You work for me. I don't work for you." It's not the way it is with God. Amen. We pray, we ask, God moves, and we trust that he moves to our best benefit. Now, everything I've said today is because of what I'm about to say in closing that God dealt with me. Go back to verse 13. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. We've talked about that. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. So we should pray when we're afflicted. We should pray when we're sick. We should pray when we've sinned. But let me say also that we should pray when everything's going good and everything seems successful. This is the hardest time. Over the past week or two, I thought about myself and I analyzed my own life. I analyzed my prayer life. We were just talking about the prayer requests by text, emails. I get them all. And when my phone dings, I look at it immediately. Not because I'm afraid I'll miss something, somebody's some joke they've sent me or a picture or anything. I don't care about none of that. I mean, I'll look at it sooner or later. But I look at it immediately because it may be from the church. I can tell you this, church. When I get a text, I get the text and the email. I normally read the text. When I read the text and it's someone in the church that has a prayer request because someone is sick, hurting, afflicted, whatever the case may be, I immediately pray for that object. I don't care where I'm at. I don't care what's going on. Maybe driving. Maybe home. I immediately stop and pray for that object. Immediately. And I'm sure, I have no doubt, many of you do the exact same thing. So if I receive a text that somebody's afflicted, I pray. If I receive a text that somebody is sick, I pray. If I was to receive a phone call and someone was to confess something to me, I will pray. Then I thought, here is my problem. When things are going good, when the text doesn't ding, when I'm not sick, when my family's not sick, when the people of this church are doing well, then my prayer life suffers. And I'm just confessing to the church. I've talked with God about this for the last 2 weeks. Because sometimes when you're sick or you're ailing or anything comes in your life, it makes you reflect. You begin to look. You got nothing else to do. And I get to thinking that, Lord, forgive me, because when things are going great at the church, when things are going good in the people's lives at the church, because you are the church, It's not the building. When all these things are going good and going good in my life, my prayer life begins to suffer. Now, I'm not saying I don't pray at all. I'm just simply saying that I haven't had the fervency, I haven't been pushed. I haven't gone to my knees like I should when things are great. I want to give you something in closing here. This is what led me to this. I want to talk about King Hezekiah in the Old Testament. Now, I'm going to give this to you quickly. God tested him in three ways. And I feel like we can all relate to this at some level or another. To where we remember, pray when we're sick, pray when we're afflicted, pray when we've sinned. But we need to pray when everything's going good and we're successful. I want to read you a quote by C.S. Lewis. Most of us know who he is. He said, God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pains. It is his megaphone to arouse a deaf world. Very true there. But the word Mary that we read here is any Mary. That very word means to be of good cheer. It suggests a time where you have no worries. That's when I tend to get slack, for the lack of better words. So I want you to listen. In closing, I want to give you King Hezekiah out of the Old Testament, three ways that God tested him. And I won't take time to read all these verses. I might read some of them, but in 2 Kings chapter 19, in verse 34 and verse 35, we see that God tested King Hezekiah when trouble came. So when trouble came his way, what would he do? Listen to what the Bible says in 2 Kings 19, 34, 35. For I will defend this city to save it for mine own sake and for my servant David's sake. And it came to pass that night that the angel of the Lord went out and smote in the camp of the Assyrians 185,000. And when they arose early in the morning, behold, they were all dead corpses. Understand, the king of Assyria came to lay siege upon Jerusalem. When he did, he had sent a letter to King Hezekiah saying that your God is unable to deliver you. What his letter said was, all these others, he starts naming off all these other cities and territories, and he says their God couldn't deliver them. Their God couldn't deliver them. Their God couldn't deliver them. What makes you think for a moment that your God could deliver you out of my hands? If you take the time to read the account, and I would encourage you to do so, but if you take the time to read the account, you will see that when King Hezekiah received the word, received the letter, the Assyrian army, 185,000 troops encamped outside Jerusalem. When he received the letter, you will find out that he sent word to Isaiah and he went straight to the house of God and in sackcloth and ashes, he began to pray to a holy God for deliverance. Can I say that King Hezekiah passed the test? Trouble came. The enemies were at the door. He turned to God and trusted God. He passed the test. The test of when trouble comes. The test of security. The second test was the test of sickness we just talked about. 2 Kings chapter 20. Look at verse 1 through 3. In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death. And the prophet Isaiah the son of Amoz came to him and said unto him, Thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Now we don't want that, do we? Nobody wants to hear those words. Especially from Isaiah. Who wants to hear those words? Let me continue. Then he turned, speaking of King Hezekiah, then he turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. You see, Hezekiah got sick. He did what James said. James said, pray. Isaiah come and said, your sickness is sickness unto death. You're gonna die. I don't know about you, but with Isaiah's track history, I believed him too. Amen. Hezekiah knew he was about to die. But he turned to the Lord and prayed, like James said, in your sickness, pray. He turned to the Lord, he prayed. God heard his prayer, and God extended his life 15 years. We should pray when we're sick. We have no problem with that, do we? King Hezekiah passed the test here. He passed the test of trusting God when trouble came. Praying. We do that. I do that. He passed the test of praying when sickness came into his life. You and I do that. I truly believe the people of this church, when they get their texts and emails, they pray for those that are sick, for those that are hurting. I truly believe that. If I didn't believe that, we'd just stop sending them out. What'd be the purpose? So he passed the test. Here comes the third test. The third test we find in 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles in chapter number 32. Hezekiah, excuse me, he had seen the miracle of the angel coming and slaying 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. He had seen that. He had gone through the sickness, he had prayed, and God had extended his life 15 years. He was experiencing that. He had been very, very successful king. He was extremely rich. He had grown the bounties. Everything was wonderful. Success had come his way. Then these envoys came from Babylon. They wanted to meet Hezekiah and see all the great things that he had done for Israel. Let's go to 2 Chronicles chapter 32, verse 30 and 31. The Bible says, "The same Hezekiah also stopped the upper water course of Gihon and brought it straight down to the west side of the city of David. And Hezekiah prospered in all his works." I mean, he was successful as king. "Howbeit, in the business of the ambassadors of the princes of Babylon, who sent unto him to inquire of the wonder that was done in the land, God left him to try him, that he might know all that was in his heart." I'm going to read you some more in a minute. But what happened? King Hezekiah had been very successful. He had prayed when trouble came. He had prayed when he was sick. And now he's so successful. Everything's going wonderful with the nation of Israel or Jerusalem. Everything's going great. And Babylon sends their ambassadors to speak to him to see how he's done all this. And what they are doing is trying to join up with him to be the security blanket because his military was not strong. So he was looking to them. He showed them everything in his kingdom. Everything. Every single thing that he felt like he had accomplished, he showed it all to them because now he was trusting in them for his security, in them for his protection rather than God. You say, "I'm not reading that." Well, turn, I'm going to read in the book of Isaiah, chapter 39, verse 5 and 6. "Then said Isaiah to Hezekiah, hear the word of the Lord of hosts. Behold, the days come that all that is in thine house and that which thy fathers have laid up in store until this day shall be carried to Babylon. Nothing shall be left, saith the Lord." God came to Hezekiah, and Hezekiah run to God, I should say, when the Assyrians were outside. And he passed the test. He went and prayed. When he was sick, he turned to God. He passed the test. But now success has come, and Hezekiah has not turned to God and pray. He has failed the test. As I said, I feel like I have failed the test many times. When things are going great, when the church is prospering, when your life is in order, when everything's going good, we tend not to pray to God. And if we're not careful, we'll be just like Hezekiah. Pride will rise up in our lives, and we'll think we've done something. That's what Hezekiah did, and God took it all away. And they were sent into captivity into Babylon. So, church, I think there's a great lesson there. I know there is for me. F.B. Meyers wrote this, and I'm closing. He said, "The greatest tragedy is not unanswered prayer, but unoffered prayer." I want to read that to you again. The greatest tragedy is not an answered prayer, because God always answers prayer. Yes, no, wait a little while. Always answers. The greatest tragedy is not unanswered prayer, but unoffered prayer. Again, in the New Testament, Jesus said, you have not because you ask not. So we should go to God in prayer when we're afflicted. Trouble comes. We should go to God in prayer when we're sick. We should go to God in prayer when everything is wonderful. And we should go to God in prayer when we've sinned. The key to the whole message today is simply to pray. Amen? To pray. And church, I had to examine myself very, very closely. I pray when I'm sick, I pray when you're sick. I pray when trouble comes into my life, I pray when it comes into your life. I pray when it comes into the church. I pray when there's sin in my life, I come to this very altar and kneel and I'll ask God to forgive me. But I got slack praying when everything is good. And for that, I had to ask God to forgive me. So I'm confessing, I've already confessed to God, and I'm confessing to you. And what I'm asking of you is, you help pray that God would give me the strength to do that very thing. Amen? Let's all heads bowed, all eyes closed just a moment. Father, we thank you for the privilege of prayer. And Lord, again, I pray for forgiveness from being slack in times of prosperity, of success, of good things. It's so easy, Lord God, to be distracted by the successes, by the blessings that you have put in our lives. It's so easy to become so distracted by all the many things that you've so richly blessed me with, our church with, that, Lord, honestly get to the point where we feel like maybe we deserve it, and it's just not true. So, Lord, I pray that for me, that you'd help me to go to my knees, not only in times of trouble and sickness and sin, but in times of plenty, of success, of good. Father, forgive us. Help us to be stronger and better Christians tomorrow than we were today. We'll not fail to give you praise, honor, and glory. In Christ's name, amen.